Can you tell me what, where did we stop last time?
Yes, sir. Last we did isomerization, that is the eighth one reaction.
Okay, so which means that we have reached till formation of 2-phosphoglyceric acid, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So the next reaction that we are going to speak about is going to be dehydration. And this is the second last reaction that you have in case of glycolysis. So I'm also casting the whiteboard. I hope it's visible to you now. So the reaction that we are going to speak about is termed as dehydration, which is the ninth reaction of glycolysis. As the name suggests, it deals with removal of water. Okay, that's why we call it as dehydration. Right now, what do we have with us is 2-PGA. 2-PGA basically looks like this. It has a phosphate group on the second carbon. That's why we call it as 2-phosphoglyceric acid. Now, in dehydration, you are going to remove a water molecule, and 2-PGA is going to be converted into an enol group. Okay. So, when you remove water, the question is where is the hydrogen and hydroxyl group coming from? So, I think it's very clear over here that we are going to get rid of this hydroxyl group. Okay, we are going to not touch the carboxylic group because we know that our end product itself is a carboxylic acid. So we are not going to play with it. Okay, pyruvic acid is a carboxylic acid. So we are not removing the hydroxyl group from there. We are removing it from the CH2OH group. And the hydrogen is going to come from the second carbon. So that's what we are going to basically do. So what we are left with is COOH, C and the phosphate group associated with it. There will be a double bond now. And what I'm left with here is CH2. And obviously water molecule is removed. So this particular compound that you see is what we call as phosphoenol pyruvic acid, which very commonly is abbreviated either as PEP, because you know that pyruvic acid is called as pyruvate, so phosphoenol pyruvate, or people also abbreviate it as PEPA, that is phosphoenol pyruvic acid. So either of it, okay? The enzyme involved here is going to be enolase, and magnesium ions are needed for the enzyme to function. They are the cofactors. The delta G for this particular reaction is minus 650 calories at pH 7. Okay, so in this step, what you have done is you have removed water molecule from 2-PGA to form an enol based compound, which is phosphoenol pyruvic acid, which can also be called as phosphoenol pyruvate. So you either abbreviate it as PEP or PEPA. It's a reversible step. The enzyme is enolase because you're forming an enol compound. The enzyme is being named as enolase, and magnesium ions are going to be your cofactors. Okay, and delta G is minus 650 calories. So the reaction is quite simple, and it's basically dealing with rearrangement of electrons. Obviously, it will, you know, release a significantly large amount of energy when hydrolysis is going to take place, and magnesium ions are required. So whatever rearrangement you are doing, that energy gain is going to happen in the next step, which is the last step of glycolysis, wherein you harvest that energy and conserve it in the form of ATP molecules. Now here we have to understand that enolase can be inhibited by fluoride ions. They are the inhibitors of the enzyme. Even if magnesium and phosphate group is present, fluoride can still inhibit enolase, thereby bringing about a halt in the process of glycolysis. So excessive concentration of fluoride for any organism could be dangerous. Okay, there is a threshold concentration beyond which fluoride ions can be very, very risky. So quickly note the reaction down. The reaction is there both on the whiteboard as well as on the presentation. Just quickly note it down and let me know once you are done with it. Okay, great. So if you're done, we can move to the next reaction. The next reaction basically is the last step of glycolysis. This step can be called as dephosphorylation because you are going to remove the phosphate group from PEPA. Or you can also refer to it as an ATP generation step because you will be generating ATP molecules in this particular step. So let us see what happens. We have PEPA with us, which is like this. So we have PEPA. Now to this, we are going to add a water molecule. Okay. It's a reversible step. Okay. And we are going to also remove the phosphate group. Okay, so how is that going to work? So let us see what happens. So this entire part is what we are going to get rid of. Fine. And the product that we are going to get is going to be COOH, C double bond O, okay, because that will come from the water that we are dealing with, and rest of the hydrogens will go ahead to complete it to make a phosphoric acid. And CH3. Okay, so one hydrogen is being used to convert CH2 to CH3. The oxygen is going to be kept there, and the phosphate group will come out as phosphoric acid. And that phosphoric acid further will donate the phosphate group to ADP and convert it into ATP. So that's how you are generating an ATP molecule. First, you make the phosphoric acid, H3PO4. From that H3PO4, the phosphate will be donated to ADP such that the ADP gets converted into ATP. Okay. Now, here you need two cofactors, one being magnesium, because you know that ADP, ATP is involved. So enzyme is going to be kinase. And the second is potassium. Both of these are cofactors. Now here we are getting pyruvic acid, which we also call as pyruvate. Okay. So the enzyme here, instead of being named on the basis of the substrate, normally whenever we write kinase, we give the prefix on the basis of the substrate. But as this is the end of glycolysis, instead of using the name of the substrate, we use the name of the product, wherein we refer to it as pyruvic kinase, the cofactor being Mg2+ and K+. Delta G for this reaction is around minus 6100 calories, which is at pH 7. Okay, so what we have basically done is we have utilized a water molecule. Okay, and the structure has been converted to COOH, C double bond O, CH3. Whatever phosphate group is removed, it's first converted into a phosphoric acid, which then donates a phosphate to ADP, thereby forming an ATP molecule. So Mg2 plus and K plus are your cofactors, and your enzyme is pyruvic kinase. Now, please understand that this particular reaction is also a very, very crucial reaction. Okay. Now, why do we say that? So it is because these, though we show as reversible reactions, in most of the cells, they have been found to be irreversible. Okay, in most of the cells, they are irreversible process, but in lab, it may be a reversible reaction. So when you, write this particular reaction, though you may show it to be a reversible process, but physiologically, it is irreversible. Okay, now, two cofactors are involved. We have already discussed that. This is an allosteric enzyme. Now, what do you mean by allosteric enzyme? So there are some components which can either upregulate the activity of the enzyme, while some of the other compounds can downregulate the activity of it. So for example, if acetyl-CoA, ATP molecules, or alanine are getting accumulated, they are going to act as negative effector molecules. Now, effector means these are those compounds which can help regulate the activity of the enzyme by binding to it. Okay. Now, negative effectors means that they are going to downregulate the activity of the enzyme. And it is obvious why these are the effector molecules. See, pyruvate se acetyl CoA banta. So, agar acetyl CoA zyada hai ya ATP zyada hai, iska ye matlab hai ki enough of the pathway has been carried out and we don't have to continue it ahead. Okay, similarly, alanine is something which is formed from the precursor molecules like acetyl-CoA. So all these would be in excess only if this pathway has been carried out for enough amount of time and we have a lot of its metabolites accumulated. So we can stop it for a while. So then these molecules will act as negative effectors. But if, you know, AMP is more, it's an indication that ATP is less. Or fructose 2,6-bisphosphate is more, which is an indication that the starting substrate is more, like glucose or fructose, then those act as positive effectors, which means that they will tell the enzyme that you need to work because there is a lack of ATP or the substrate is very high in concentration. Let us start doing the pathway or start carrying out the pathway. Right? So there are both negative as well as positive effectors. Have you understood this concept? That why specific molecules are acting as negative effectors and why specific molecules are acting as positive effectors?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, how do these enzymes switch from their active to inactive and inactive to active state? It's very important for us to know. See, if enzymes have to be activated or inactivated, there has to be some chemical modification that is taking place there with the enzyme. Okay. So this switching between active and inactive states could be due to some covalent modifications. For some, it could be acetylation. For some, it could be methylation. For some, it could be phosphorylation, which means that adding a phosphate group may make the enzyme go into an inactive state. While removing that phosphate group will make the enzyme switch to its active state. Now, let me tell you that this is also very much flexible a concept because it varies from one protein and one enzyme to the other, wherein you will see that for some of the enzymes, phosphorylation brings about activation. Okay. While for some enzymes, phosphorylation brings about inactivation. So it depends on where phosphorylation has taken place. And what effect does that addition of phosphate group have on the catalysis of the enzyme? Okay. So it's not that for all enzymes, phosphorylation means inactivation, or for all enzymes, phosphorylation means activation, activation. It could change from one enzyme to the other. Now, in case of pyruvic kinase, phosphorylation means inactivation, which means if you add a phosphate group to pyruvate kinase, it's going to be inactivated. So if there is an increase in the concentration of ATP, alanine, acetyl-CoA, then pyruvate kinase is going to be phosphorylated. So you can see in the presentation, I'm showing you a mechanism that when ATP, alanine, acetyl-CoA is increased, a phosphate group is added to pyruvate kinase. How is that addition taking place? ATP is doing that addition. So ATP is donating a phosphate group. So it's a protein kinase functioning over here and getting converted into ADP, thereby phosphorylating pyruvate kinase and inactivating it. So it will not work. But whenever AMP concentration or fructose 2,6 bisphosphate concentration will increase, mind you, it's not 1,6 bisphosphate, it is 2,6 bisphosphate, which we will discuss during regulation. That will activate pyruvate kinase by dephosphorylating it. So for dephosphorylating it, for removing a phosphate, we need a phosphatase, which will remove the phosphate group attached to pyruvate kinase and convert it back to its active form, to its dephosphorylated form. Okay, so now the enzyme is active to carry out the conversion of PEPA to pyruvic acid. Are you all understanding this? Others, mujhe sirf do awaaze sunai di hai. To baakiyon ka kya status hai? Samjha hai, nahi samjha hai?
Yes, sir.
Can you repeat
once
again?
Yes, sir.
So pyruvate kinase, as I told you that, in presence of some effector molecules like ATP, alanine, your acetyl-CoA, all these three molecules, when they accumulate inside the cell, what is it indicating? It is indicating that enough of respiratory pathway has been done. Ye sab ab accumulate ho chuke hain. Matlab bahut zyada respiration ho chuka hai, metabolism ho chuka hai. To thode vakt ke liye hum is particular process ko rok sakte hain. Jab tak ye metabolites use up nahi ho jate. Okay, so we can stop this process. So how will you stop it? You will stop it by inactivating the enzyme. How do you inactivate pyruvate kinase? You are inactivating pyruvate kinase by adding a phosphate group to it. So the moment you add a phosphate group to pyruvate kinase, it will not carry out the catalytic function. Now, how is it phosphorylated? A protein kinase will add a phosphate group to pyruvate kinase, making it phosphorylated pyruvate kinase. PYK stands for pyruvate kinase. So who is the donor of phosphate group? ATP, getting converted into ADP. But when AMP concentrations are more, or when fructose 2,6 bisphosphate concentration is more, it's indicating that we don't have enough ATP. Rather, we have a lot of substrate which needs to be metabolized, like fructose or glucose. So we will have to activate the enzyme. How do we activate it? Remove the phosphate group from it. How do you remove it? You need a phosphatase. So phosphatase functions in presence of water, and a phosphate group is removed. So my pyruvate kinase is now dephosphorylated and it has gone back to its active state. Is this now clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so can you guys quickly note first the 10th reaction and then also the phosphorylation, dephosphorylation part, which I will put up once you're done with this. Just let me know. I will switch the slides for you to note that down.
Sir,
Yes.
what's that negative sign below D-phosphopyruvate
It should be positive. It's to indicate that the enzyme is active at that state. And negative in case of phosphorylated pyruvic acid to indicate that it's inactive at that state.
kinase? Okay, sir, thank you.
Okay, so let's move ahead. Now, please understand that we had in the beginning of the second phase of glycolysis two molecules of 3-phosphoglyceraldehyde, right? We started with two molecules of 3-PGAL in the second phase of glycolysis. But we have shown all reactions according to one molecule. Okay, but understand that all the molecules, rather both the molecules of pGal, will undergo the same process. Okay, they are going to have the same set of reactions, they are going to have simultaneous conversions. So it means that two molecules of 3-pGal will get converted into two molecules of 1,3-bisphosphoglyceric acid. Those two molecules will get converted to two molecules of 3-phosphoglyceric acid, which will get converted to two molecules of 2-phosphoglyceric acid, which will get converted to two molecules of PEPA, and finally two molecules of pyruvic acid. So all conversions that you have shown, right? So that has to be according to two molecules. So for example, let me tell you what I am trying to explain over here. In this reaction, you would have two NAD getting converted into two NADH and H plus. You will need two molecules of phosphoric acid. In the next reaction, you will have two ADP molecules getting converted into two ATP molecules. The next reaction, there is nothing wherein we have a coenzyme involved. Then you will have two water molecules released over here, right? And in the final step, you will have two water molecules being added, two phosphates being removed, so two ADP getting converted into two ATP. So everything will double up, okay? So we, if focus on how much of ATP molecules we have utilized and we have generated, this is the stats. We have utilized two ATP molecules. Can you tell me where we have utilized two ATP molecules? Now all reactions are in front of you. So you should be able to tell me कहाँ हमने दो ATP molecules का खर्चा किया है?
So in the first step itself, we have used 180p.
In the first step, very good.
And in
And in the
that
phosphate.
phosphorylation.
Yes, what did we form there?
Fructose 1,6-DPP.
Fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. Very good. So we utilized one ATP in the first step, that is glucose to glucose 6-phosphate, and second ATP while converting fructose 6-phosphate to 1,6-bisphosphate. Agreed, all of you?
Yes, sir.
Very good.
Yes, sir.
How many ATPs have we produced? So production did not take place in the first phase, right? It happened only in the second phase. So how many ATPs have we produced? And where? Can you tell me that? एक रिएक्शन तो आ
सर
गया।
इन डीफॉस्फोरिलेशन
See, there are two dephosphorylations. So stop speaking in terms of reaction names. Tell me
And
the
we produce a phosphoglyceric acid.
which phosphoglyceric acid? There are two phosphoglyceric acids. Your
Three
problem.
phosphoglyceric
This is
acid.
your problem. Understand the question and answer to the point. Don't make a hurry. You're not getting a Nobel Prize here. So it is 3 phosphoglyceric acid. When you converted 1,3 bisphosphoglyceric acid to 3 phosphoglyceric acid, you generated ATP molecules, right? So if we see according to one glucose molecule, how many ATPs did we generate at that step?
Two.
Very good. Two molecules. Why? Because हमारे पास दो 3P गैल के molecules थे, तो सब कुछ सारे reaction दो molecules के हिसाब से होने वाले हैं ना? तो उस reaction में हमने दो ATP generate किए. दूसरा step कौन सा था जहां हमने ATP generate किया?
Conversion of PEPA to pyruvic acid.
Conversion of PEPA to pyruvic acid. So how many ATPs are we generating at that step?
Two again,
right? So please understand that whenever you generate ATPs outside electron transport chain, see normally in aerobic respiration, maximum ATPs are generated in ETC. But whenever you generate ATPs outside the oxidative phosphorylation, outside the electron transport chain, you refer to it as substrate level phosphorylation. I'm sure that you have come across this term in SY, right? So that's what we refer to as substrate level phosphorylation when you are generating ATPs outside the terminal oxidation, outside ETC. You are going to call it as substrate level phosphorylation. In this process, you are generating 4 ATP molecules from one glucose. But you have taken a loan of 2 ATP molecules earlier. So what is my net gain going to be? Because I have to pay for those 2 ATPs. That's why I used to call the second phase as payoff phase, right? So now I have to pay for those 2 ATPs. So what's my net gain going to be? 4 minus 2. So my net gain is going to be 2 molecules. Is that very, very clear to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. How many NADH molecules did you generate in this process from one glucose? And where? I don't want Akhil and Akshay to reply. Others, how many NADH molecules did we generate and where?
So we got NADH in the reaction, like the conversion of 1,3 bisphosphoglyceric acid to 3 phosphoglyceric acid, one from each molecule, so total 2 in that reaction.
Very good. So we have 2 NADH H plus molecules generated. Very good. Keep a note of that. Keep that written somewhere. We will come back to this in some time. Okay. The next question is, how many water molecules did we release in the process? How many water molecules did we release in the process?
Sir,
Akshay, chup bait.
Sir, doubt. Sir,
ruk ja.
Yes.
Yes, Nirmiti, can you tell me how many water molecules did we release?
Yes, sir. In while conversion of 2 phosphoglycerate to phosphoenol pyruvic acid, we released 2.
So, how many water molecules are we releasing in the process?
2.
Why 2?
Because we are doubling up.
Doubling up. Why are we doubling up?
Right, sir, because we used 2, we have 2 PGAL phosphoglyceric acid.
We have 2 molecules of it. Okay.
Yeah.
Fine. Shamika, can you tell me how many water molecules are we utilizing in this process? Yes. How many water molecules are we utilizing in this process? Anyone? अरे बाप रे, इतना टाइम क्यों लग रहा है? Yes.
Sir, we even here we have to use two
Which step?
molecules. In the conversion of phosphoenol pyruvic acid to pyruvic acid, that is last.
In the last step. Okay, so
Yes.
two water molecules released, two water molecules utilized, right? Yes, Akshay, बोल अभी.
Sir, in that NADH1, we are getting like in two steps, right? NADH formation. Like first one is that we are getting the product of 1,3 bisphosphoglyceric acid in that one, and in this also dephosphorylation, that is formation of 3-phosphoglyceric acid.
In 3-phosphoglyceric acid, we do not have any NADH involved, Akshay. I don't know what you are talking about. 3-phosphoglyceric acid formation is just a dephosphorylation. Where did you have NADH there? You have
So in
NADH.
the reaction it's written
अच्छा ओके दैट्स कंबाइंड वन
that
ओके सर
combined वाला.
तो
यस सर
कंबाइंड
हाँ हाँ
फॉर्मेशन.
हाँ सर कंफ्यूज अब नाउ यस सर
हाँ, डोंट गेट कंफ्यूज. देर इज NADH फॉर्मेशन ओनली इन वन स्टेप. देर वी रोट इट बिकॉज वी वर शोइंग टू रिएक्शंस टुगेदर, ऑक्सीडेटिव फॉस्फोराइलेशन एज वेल एज डीफॉस्फोराइलेशन, राइट? बिकॉज वी वर शोइंग इट फ्रॉम द लेवल ऑफ 3-PGAL टू द फॉर्मेशन ऑफ 3-PGA. Okay, so NADH formation is only at one step, and that step is oxidative phosphorylation. So you have two NADH involved there. Okay. Now, if anyone is going to see, there are multiple ways of putting up this question to confuse you. Okay. So listen to me carefully. If people are going to ask you how many ATPs did you produce by SLP for one glucose, what will be your answer?
Four.
Four. Barabar. If I ask you that how many ATPs did you produce by SLP for three glucose molecules? What will be your answer?
So 12.
12. So be prepared. These kind of questions will come. Okay. Next question, if they ask you what is the net gain of ATP from one molecule of glucose in glycolysis? Your answer is going to be 2. Barabar? Net gain. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. But if anyone puts the question up as, what is the total gain of ATPs from one glucose in glycolysis during complete aerobic respiration? I'm repeating the question. What is the total gain of ATPs from one glucose in glycolysis during complete aerobic respiration? So what will be your answer?
So 8, right?
How will you get 8?
I counted the NADH also, like 2 NADH and then the 2 net gain.
So remember that NADH that you produce here goes into ETC. Okay. And in ETC, it is going to produce ATP molecules. So when I say complete aerobic respiration, it means that I have to count what happens to the NADH produced in glycolysis. So then the 2 NADH molecule will give me 5 ATP molecules. Now, till your lower classes, till your 12th standard, you used to say that 1 NADH gives you 3 ATP molecules. But let me tell you, that's not correct. 1 NADH gives you 2.5 moles of ATP. Remember this. Okay, the energy is equivalent to 2.5 ATP molecules in one NADH. So if I have two NADH, how many ATP molecules am I generating? 2.5 into 2, which is 5. Right? And plus the net gain to it. So plus 2. So the total will come to 7 instead of 8. I'm sure that in neat preparation, people would have told you that it's 8 because 6 from NADH, 2 NADH and 2 net gain. So 6 plus 2 gives you 8. But here, you will refer to it as 5 plus 2, which is 7. Is that clear to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes. But this yes. will also change depending on which cell is involved in this process. And what is that we will see when we discuss bioenergetics, because I don't want to confuse you now. But itna concept tumko samjha hai na ki total ATP produced by SLP from one glucose is 4. Net gain is 2. Total gain of ATP from one glucose in glycolysis by complete aerobic respiration is 7. ठीक है तो फिर उसके बाद तुमको कितना भी ग्लूकोज मॉलिक्यूल का पूछने दो अगर तुमको एक का वैल्यू पता है तो बाकी चीजें इजियर है अभी ये रट्टा मारने का नहीं क्योंकि तुम रट्टा जितना मारोगे तुम्हारा बैंड बजने वाला है क्योंकि हर प्रोसेस में स्पेसिफिक नंबर ऑफ एटीपी मॉलिक्यूल्स है तो तुम सब बैठ के रट नहीं सकते हो तो समझ के लो कौन से रिएक्शन पे क्या हो रहा है दैट विल मेक योर लाइफ इजियर आई होप You are with me and are understanding all these things. Guys.
Yes, sir.
बंदा बायोकेमिस्ट्री में तुम लोग को पढ़ाएगा मैं छोड़ देगा पढ़ाना मैं बोलेगा हाँ ठीक है इनको रिएक्शन लिख के दिखाया खत्म हो गया काम खत्म आई विल माइंड माई बिजनेस इफ यू आर नॉट गोइंग टू बी रिस्पॉन्सिव आई एम सीइंग यू गोइंग बैक टू योर SY स्टेट वो तुम्हारा एक पैटर्न है कि मतलब ब्रेक होता है ब्रेक के बाद तुम पूरे एंथुसियाज्म के साथ आते हो फिर प्लेन की तरह क्रैश करते हो जमीन पे आई डोंट वांट दैट हैपनिंग प्लीज आई सीरियसली डोंट वांट दैट हैपनिंग एंड आई एम सीइंग दैट गुड स्टूडेंट्स आर नॉट परफॉर्मिंग वेल इन द टेस्ट्स नॉट जस्ट दिस बट इवन द प्रैक्टिकल टेस्ट आई डोंट नो वॉट इज गोइंग रॉन्ग बट You have to understand this, that the loss in this case is going to be solely yours. Believe me. Am I going to be at loss or other teachers are going to be at loss? Not at all. Are we going to get the degree in the process? No. So losing interest is going to be a disastrous thing to do, students. Especially, please keep this in mind that you are already at a loss. Don't you all agree?
Yes, sir.
So in that, if you are going to be like this, if you are going to be least interactive, I am seriously not going to take efforts. I will do much other, you know, much better things which will benefit me. This is not acceptable. Why should I get up in the morning to teach the walls? It's none of my business. So if you are going to be like this, I will stop all my efforts and I will go back home. I'm being stupid taking the efforts for you if you are going to be like this. Okay, because I am seeing the test scores, they are really very discouraging. Let me tell you that. Which clearly shows you're not working hard. TY is a year to work hard. You have to sit and study. You have no option. If you want a good career, if you want a master's in a good institution, then you have to work hard for it. And these are central metabolic pathways. You can't take it lightly. You just cannot take it lightly. So in tomorrow's lecture, I don't want you like this. And believe me, if you're like this, I will just finish the syllabus as a lightning speed. You won't even realize that biochemistry syllabus is over. And don't challenge me to do that. I can very well do it. 2017, I have done that with the TY batch. That I don't care. If you are not interested, I am not going to invest my time. So I will just, you know, blabber something out and I will say my syllabus is over. Then you are left with your study materials to do whatever you want to do. Okay. I have a task for all of you. The task is writing the entire glycolysis in the form of a flowchart. तुमने 12वीं में भी देखा होगा ना तुम कैसे लिखते हो पूरा पाथवे एज वन स्कीमेटिक सो यू हैव टू राइट द एंटायर ग्लाइकोलाइसिस एज अ स्कीमेटिक विल यू डू दैट
यस सर
यस
सर
यस सर यस
सर बिकॉज़ ऑल रिएक्शंस विल बी एट वन प्लेस एंड व्हेनेवर यू वांट टू रिवाइज यू आर जस्ट लुकिंग एट इट सो देख के लिखो मैं ये भी नहीं बोल रहा बिना देख के लिखो But see to it that you're including everything. Okay? I will tell you just screen share karke how I am expecting you to write it. So you can write it in a similar format. So what you are going to do is look at the whiteboard. You will write the structure of glucose. Okay, let us say you have written the structure of glucose. You are going to show what is involved in the process. You're going to write the name of the enzyme. You're going to write the cofactor. And you're going to write the name of the reaction. With structures. Okay. So if there are intermediate steps, show that also. It's fine. The enzyme name, reaction name will remain the same. Like you had cysteine diol formation during isomerization. So if there are intermediate steps, show that. So you will write the entire glycolysis in the form of a schematic. I will create an assignment submission link on the website and you're going to submit it. It's not going to be marked, but I will surely correct it. If there are mistakes, I will let you know. So you are going to write it. You are going to click images and you are going to upload it either as image or PDF, whatever is comfortable to you. Is that fine? Can you do this yes, by the coming weekend?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So we'll meet tomorrow. We'll first discuss the regulation of glycolysis. And we'll start with the next pathway, which is very closely related to glycolysis, which is ED pathway. And then we will revisit what we discussed earlier in this unit about evolution of carbon dioxide and which carbon it is coming from. And how do you compare that it's ED or glycolysis, which we have discussed earlier already, right? So we will revisit that. Okay, fine. That is it for today. See you all tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.